The NCAA thought that this guy, along with the Steelworkers Union, couldn't make a difference and change the landscape of college sports forever. He's done it. And please join me in welcoming the new president of the College Athletes Players Association, my friend Ramogi Huma.
Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right. Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right. Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right.
Thank you very much. First, I'd like to say that it's an honor to be here today and to be able to be introduced by Tim Waters. Tim has worked tirelessly to support our cause and has been a tremendous asset for college athletes. I'm looking forward to telling you a little bit about the College Athletes Rights Movement and our recently formed union, CAPA. But first, I'd like to thank Steelworkers International President Leo Girard for inviting me here today and for his unyielding support that spans well over a decade. And I'd also like to thank the entire Steelworkers Board for supporting this movement since 2000, when it wasn't popular and when no one else was willing to help. And on behalf of Northwestern football players and college athletes across the nation, I want to thank the thousands of Steelworkers members who sent messages of encouragement and support. That support means the world to us, and I wanted to come here today and say thank you. There are a lot of people who think that our union effort at Northwestern was the first step we've taken to protect college athletes. But in reality, it's that we fought for college athletes' rights for over 13 years. And throughout this time, the Steelworkers provided vital assistance in strategic planning, communications, and fundraising, and more. And together, we've been able to make some progress over the years through various forms of pressure. But despite our efforts and over $1.2 billion in brand new TV revenue, the NCAA, the conferences, and universities have refused to provide basic protections for college athletes. Today, colleges are not required to pay for any sports-related medical expenses, not one penny. You can ask former Oklahoma basketball player Kyle Hardrick about that. He was left to pay thousands of dollars in medical expenses from a knee surgery that he needed after being injured in practice. And you may remember the gruesome injury caught on TV during last year's NCAA March Madness basketball tournament. Louisville player Kevin Ware had his leg snap in half during the game on television. And Louisville was asked whether or not it would take care of Kevin's medical expenses if he needed surgery down the line. Spokesperson responded with no comment. And by the way, Louisville basketball players generate the most revenue in the entire nation. Universities are also free to revoke scholarships for players in good standing for any reason, even injury. Former Rice football player Joe Agnew is among the many athletes whose scholarships wasn't honored after he was injured. We've all heard that the NCAA's rhetoric about academics being first, but in college sports, the money's first. That's why graduation rates for football and basketball players continue to hover around 50%, and the NCAA refuses to use some of its billions of dollars for degree completion. And perhaps most shameful is the NCAA's refusal to implement concussion reform, despite the mounting evidence of severe short and long-term health risks. There have been numerous tragedies where former NFL players committed suicide and were later found to have been suffering from CTE, chronic traumatic encephalopathy. It's a degenerative brain condition linked to contact sports. College athletes face the same risks. And proof of this was found after Penn football player Owen Thomas committed suicide at the age of 21. He was found to have CTE. And this tragedy occurred in 2010, yet NCAA Sports has refused to implement common sense protections that the NFL Players Association was able to secure for NFL athletes. And despite the national debate on this topic for the last few years, there have been several instances where players were kept in games with obvious concussion symptoms. While playing quarterback for the University of Arizona, Matt Scott suffered two hits to the head in the same play while being tackled in a game against USC. He immediately started to vomit, yet he was allowed to continue playing without any examination from his team's medical staff. Robert Woods had a similar experience while playing football for USC. And after a violent collision, Woods tried to jog off the field but stumbled for several yards before falling face first on the ground. Slow to get up, he began rocking towards the wrong sideline. He was back playing in the same game within minutes. These examples and more were captured on TV. In the midst of mounting evidence, a national dialogue about the severe short and long-term health risks of traumatic brain injury. College athletes continue to face unnecessary brain trauma risks because the NCAA and its universities refuse to act. We reached out to the NCAA and conference commissioners and urged them to act immediately, but were met with closed doors. Today, the NCAA is being sued over its inaction on concussions. And discovery in that lawsuit revealed an internal email from the NCAA from its enforcement department. The same department that suspended my teammate over eating groceries when he was hungry. The same office that punished Ohio State football players for selling their own bowl ring. Same office that investigated Johnny Manziel over whether or not he received a few bucks for signing autographs. The email said that the NCAA would not punish a coach for putting a player's health at risk by knowingly playing a player who has a concussion. And the NCAA cut straight to the point in its legal defense, which is actually filed in court documents. It says, and this is a quote, "The NCAA has no legal duty to protect student athletes." After years of advocating for college athletes' rights and the NCAA's inaction on concussions, it's become clear to me that public pressure, legislative efforts, and lawsuits are not enough to bring comprehensive reform that college athletes desperately need. These players need more than an advocacy group. College athletes need a union. Soon after I concluded this, Northwestern quarterback Kane Coulter came to me because he also believes college athletes need a union. A few months later, with Kane's tremendous leadership and the backing of the United Steelworkers, football players at Northwestern universities made history when they became the first college athletes to assert their rights under the labor laws by signing CAPA union cards. These courageous players signed union cards because college athletes across the nation are subject to unjust NCAA rules that put them at physical, financial, and academic risk. They sign union cards because universities are free to stick players with medical bills while they shower their coaches with multi-million-dollar salaries. They sign union cards because NCAA sports needlessly treats their brains as collateral damage. They sign union cards because players are used as human advertisements for shoe companies, but can lose their eligibility for eating groceries when they're hungry. They moved to join CAPA for the same reason you all joined the United Steelworkers, to fight for the dignity and protections that people deserve as human beings, as American citizens who work hard each and every day. After they signed the cards, many doubted that we'd win. But thanks to a strong legal team assembled by Steelworkers General Counsel Rich Breen, Northwestern football players made history again when the NLRB director ruled that college athletes are employees with the right to unionize. This historic ruling ends a period of 60 years in which the NCAA knowingly established a pay-for-play system while using terms like student athlete and amateurism to try to deny athletes their rights under the laws. You may have read headlines of Northwestern University's high-pressure anti-union campaign, but the precedent has been set. Regardless of how the vote turns out, we expect that the NLRB will uphold this decision, which will give college athletes at private colleges across the nation the right to unionize. This year, we've seen explosive progress in the college athletes' rights movement, and we received some good news just a few days ago when a federal judge ruled in college athletes' favor in the O'Bannon versus NCAA lawsuit. The judge ruled that the NCAA has been operating illegally by using players' images in video games and elsewhere, and must allow schools the freedom to increase their scholarship to cover basic costs and some commercial revenue to former athletes. Though we've made groundbreaking progress, the fight won't be easy. The NCAA plans to appeal this decision and has a war chest of over $500 million to fight our push for basic protections. We truly have a long way to go, and we're up against a powerful cartel. And I'm fully aware that workers' rights are under constant attack in this nation, and college athletes are no exception. After our NLRB victory, Ohio Republicans passed a state law excluding college athletes from labor law protections, and the Republicans in Congress are seeking to do the same. But those who would try to deny and strip away the rights of college athletes and other working Americans are on the wrong side of history. This is America, and we shouldn't have to forfeit our rights as a condition of employment. And for the young people here and across the nation fighting to strengthen workers' rights, take notice of who it is challenging this unjust multi-billion dollar industry. Who's making college presidents and conference commissioners scramble to try to defend the indefensible? Who's inspiring people in this country to rethink what is right and what is wrong? It's a small group of 18 to 22 year olds fighting for workers' rights. They stood up, they stood together, and they won. So please continue to stand up, stand together, and the workers in this nation will win. The progress that Northwestern football players have already made gives us reason to celebrate, but this progress would have never been possible without the support of the United Steelworkers. And the Steelworkers could have easily declined to get involved, but have instead stood side by side with college athletes since 2000. And this progress wouldn't have been made possible without the efforts of the people right here in this room and throughout organized labor who defend workers' rights day in and day out. Without you, those who oppose workers' rights would have won long ago, and Northwestern football players would have nowhere to turn for justice. We know that for every new story about our fight, there are countless dedicated activists that are making our movement possible and protecting our rights. So please accept our utmost gratitude for defending workers' rights and for giving us hope. With your support, players will continue to have an opportunity to stand up. And as workers stand up, injustice falls down. Thank you for having me today. God bless. Heaven is under the earth. I know you don't know what life is really worth. It's a cord that Peter is rolled. After story had never been told. So now you see the light. Hey, stand up for your right. Just a quick tidbit too. This is something that, you know, we knew was going to be pretty big and capture national headlines. We didn't quite know how big it would be, but according to all the analytics, in the 2 weeks following the Northwestern decision, over 300 million viewers on TV, 300 readers in print were exposed to this cause, were exposed to the fact that this union is supporting this effort. And we couldn't be more happy, more grateful. And at this point, those players at Northwestern's, when they signed those cards and with the back of the Steelworkers, they've done more to elevate the discussion about right and wrong in college sports than really has been made over the last decade. So please, again, once again, please accept our gratitude. Thank you very much. All right. Yeah. Get up.